Hello, everyone. We will have our official good morning and welcome here in just a second, but I am here to remind you, especially all of you who are voting members of the church, that we do have a special meeting today to approve our ability to sign our contract for our facade work. You will have seen this over the past months that our facade needs some repairs. It's the sort of thing that should be done every 40 or 50 years, and we're coming up on 100 years, which is why we have a little bit of a leak that's let some water into the organ. So we are ready to go with this repair, but we do need the congregation to vote to approve our ability to enter into the contract. So if you are a voting member, we ask, especially if you are a voting member, we ask that you stick around after worship and come down to Fisk Hall for that meeting. If you must leave, if you absolutely must, please log in on Zoom so that you can vote when that time comes. And if you are at home, of course, we also want you to log in to Zoom to be a part of that meeting. You will find the link for that in your weekly news and in the special reminder that I sent out yesterday. Thank you all very, very much.
Good morning. And welcome to the Universalist Church in which love is the spirit. We're glad you're here. Here in the sanctuary or anywhere in the world, especially those visiting or returning after a time away. I'm Joe Wilson, one of your representatives on our Board of Trustees. If you're a visitor, we hope you'll talk with our welcome team or visit our webpage. That's www.westhartforduu.org to learn more about us. Our guest book or online contact page will help you get onto our electronic mailing list. Our electronic communications are the best way for us to stay connected. We look forward to helping you become part of this Universalist Church. We're grateful for the fading respiratory illnesses, and masks are always welcome here. If you'd like a mask, our ushers can give you one. After worship, we'll have fellowship back in Fisk Hall and through Zoom. So I'm going to follow up on what Reverend Adams said. Those folks watching on YouTube, at 11 o'clock, you can switch over to the Zoom link that's been sent out to be part of the Zoom part of it. So please do that so we can vote on the contract. If you need help finding your way to Fisk Hall for our fellowship hour, any member of the church will be happy to guide you. Just look for someone wearing a Universalist Church name tag. You can find the link for Zoom in your weekly news or our Breeze calendar. If you aren't getting the weekly news, please sign up for it on our website. Now, I invite you to take a moment to make your mobile phone silent, turn off your email, put away your keyboards, and settle in for worship. Now, let's begin this special Shakespeare Sunday with these words from The Merchant of Venice. Please close your eyes, no peeking now, and imagine it's nighttime by the canal in Venice as Lorenzo speaks to Jessica. How sweet the moonlight sleeps upon this bank. Here will we sit and let the sounds of music creep in our ears. Soft stillness and the night become the touches of sweet harmony. Sit, Jessica. Look how the floor of heaven is thick inlaid with patines of bright gold. There's not the smallest orb that thou beholdst, but in his motion, like an angel sings, still choiring to the young-eyed cherubims, such harmony is in immortal souls.
Thank you. unto the sweet bird's throat, unto the sweet bird's throat, and to his merry note, unto the sweet bird's throat. Come hither, come hither, come hither. My voice is ragged. I know I cannot please you.
I do not desire you to please me. I do desire you to sing. Come, more, another stanza.
I'll end the song. The Duke will drink under this tree. He hath been all this day to look to you.
And I have been all this day to look to him. Come, marvel, come. Who God
sing it.
Thus it goes. If it do come to pass that any man turn ass, leaving his wealth and ease, a servant will to please, to dummy! To dummy! To dummy! Here shall he see gross fools as he, and if he will come to me.
What's that, do dummy? Oh, 'tis Greek. It is an invocation to call fools into a circle.
As an unperfect actor on the stage, who with his fear is put beside his part, or some fierce thing replete with too much rage, whose strength's abundance weakens his own heart. So I, for fear of trust, forget to say the perfect ceremony of love's rite, and in mine own love's strength seem to decay, or charged with burden of mine own love's might. Oh, let my looks be then the eloquence and dumb presagers of my speaking breast, who plead for love and look for recompense more than that tongue that more hath more expressed. Oh, learn to read what silent love hath writ. To hear with eyes belongs to love's fine wit.
Please stand in body or spirit.
Thank you.
join us in our Unison Affirmation? Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. You may be seated. Today, instead of singing the children out to their classrooms, Jesse will play the mandolin, and so when you hear him begin to play, that is your cue. Our time for all ages comes from A Midsummer Night's Dream. Titania, queen of the fairies, is coming to the rescue of a young child. In this speech, which we've refashioned into a dialogue, we learn about the queen's special relationship to the child. It is a brief but powerful testimony to friendship. Set your heart at rest. The fairyland buys not the child of me. His mother was a votaress of my order.
And in the spicy Indian air by night, full often hath I gossiped by your side.
And sat with me on Neptune's yellow sands, marking the embarked traders on the flood.
When we have laughed to see the sails conceive and grow big-bellied with the wanton wind.
Which she, with pretty and with swimming gait, her womb then rich with my young squire, would imitate and sail upon the land.
And fetch trifles, then return again, as from a voyage, rich with merchandise.
But she, being mortal, of that boy did die. And for her sake do I rear up her boy, and for her sake I will not part with him. In observation of Earth Day, we share our offering this month with the Interreligious Eco-Justice Network, Connecticut's only faith-based environmental nonprofit, whose mission is to protect our planet through education, engagement, and advocacy. Shakespearean texts, while replete with descriptions of natural beauty, do not speak often of stewardship of the land. Here is an exception. These lines are from Henry V and are spoken by the Duke of Burgundy as he begs the kings of England and France to make peace, petitioning for the end of a war that has laid waste to the land, progress, and humankind. What rub or what impediment is there? Why, that the naked, poor, and mangled peace, dear nurse of arts, plenties, and joyful births, should not in this best garden of the world, our fertile France, put up her lovely visage? Alas, she hath from France too long been chased, and all her husbandry dies and lies in heaps, corrupting in its own fertility. Her vine, the merry cheerer of our heart, unpruned dies. The even mead that erst brought sweetly forth the freckled cowslip, burnet and green clover, wanting the scythe, all uncorrected rank, conceives by idleness, and nothing teems but hateful docks, rough thistles, kexies, burrs, losing both beauty and utility. And as our vineyards, fallows, meads, and hedges, defective in their natures, grow to wildness, even so our houses and ourselves and children have lost or do not learn for want of time the sciences that should become our country, but grow like savages, as soldiers will that nothing do but meditate on blood. To swearing and stern looks, diffused attire, and everything that seems unnatural, which to reduce into our former favor, you are assembled, and my speech entreats that I may know the let why gentle peace shouldn't bless us with her former qualities.
Please rise for our doxology. Sometimes there are no words. Sometimes words stick in our throats. Sometimes, even when we do find our breath and something like the right words, the speech we speak betrays the depth of our pain. We are thankful for artists who compose, sculpt, dance, paint, sing, play in ways that honor and give voice to our experience, in ways regular words fail. And although poets use words, they use, as Samuel Coleridge famously said, the best words in the best order. And thanks be for that.
When to the sessions of sweet, silent thought, I summon up remembrance of things past. I sigh the lack of many a thing I sought, and with old woes new wail my dear time's waste. Then can I drown an eye, unused to flow, for precious friends, hid in death's dateless night, and weep afresh love's long since cancelled woe, and moan the expense of many a vanished sight. Then can I grieve at grievances foregone, and heavily from woe to woe tell o'er the sad account of four bemoaned moan, which I knew pay as if not before. But if the while I think on thee, dear friend, all losses are restored and sorrows end.
Homily, Part 1. Ms. Kelly Hunter of the Royal Shakespeare Company in London is an award-winning actor, director, and educator. Her work with Shakespeare and autism forms the basis of a longitudinal study at Ohio State University. While others have been satisfied for over a millennium that Shakespeare has healing properties, Hunter's 2015 book, Shakespeare's Heartbeat, is a revelation for those who seek scientific proof. In it, Hunter describes how Shakespeare uses poetry to marry our senses and thoughts, especially to integrate sight, thought, and the virtue of love. Said another way, by Hunter, Shakespeare's texts are a poetic exploration of how it feels to be human, how it feels to be alive, how it feels to expressively communicate. This is a fundamental concept in his writing, she says, and was her jumping off point for inventing the work she does with children on every point of the autism spectrum. She says, by focusing on Shakespeare's definitions of seeing, thinking, and loving, I stumbled upon the processes that those on the spectrum find so difficult to achieve. Children with autism experience varying degrees of difficulty with communication, all of which can be understood as a disassociation of body and mind. Expressing feelings, making eye contact, accessing their mind's eye, their dreams, keeping a steady heartbeat, and recognizing faces are all part of the autism dilemma and are all poetically explored by Shakespeare. Embedding these unattainable skills within games derived from moments of Shakespeare, which the children could play and thereby benefit from, seemed like the most natural thing in the world. The other fundamental concept Hunter puts into action is the claim Shakespeare and other poets make by writing in iambic meter. Glasses. Iambic rhythm mimics the heartbeat. It is one of the first sounds we hear in the womb and arguably produces an universally felt sensation of safety and warmth. The heartbeat circle, which begins and ends Hunter's sessions with the children, invites all to sit together, hands on hearts, and beating out the rhythm of the heartbeat while saying, hello, hello, and practicing facial expressions. The soothing power of the iambic rhythm, together with Shakespeare's poetic exploration of how it feels to be alive, make up the two concepts which underpin the games, all of which hold onto the essential aim of the work, using the fundamental Shakespearean themes to combat the communicative blocks of autism. Professor of Humanities at Yale, while simultaneously holding the same post in English at NYU. He died in 2019. He remains America's most famous literary critic. Bloom has written over 50 books, 40 of which are literary criticism. He is the preeminent old school scholar, stubborn and brilliant, who the younger ilk cannot resist battling on paper. His 1998 book, Shakespeare, The Invention of the Human, deserves only to be quoted here at length with no argument from the likes of me. The more one reads Shakespeare and ponders his plays, the more one realizes that the accurate stance toward them is one of awe. How he was possible, I cannot know. My book, though it hopes to be useful to others, is a personal statement, the expression of a long, though hardly unique, passion. Bardolatry, the worship of Shakespeare, ought to be even more a secular religion than it already is. The plays remain the outward limit of human achievement, aesthetically, cognitively, in certain ways morally, even spiritually. They abide beyond the end of the mind's reach. We cannot catch up to them. Shakespeare will go on explaining us, in part because he invented us, which is the central argument of my book. A more conservative way of stating this would seem to me a weak misreading of Shakespeare. It might contend that Shakespeare's originality was in the representation of cognition, personality, character. And what he's specifically referring to here is the aside, the idea that a character could look out and self-reflect for a moment. But there is an overflowing element in the plays, an excess beyond representation that is closer to the metaphor we call creation. The dominant Shakespearean characters, Falstaff, Hamlet, Rosalind, Iago, Lear, Macbeth, Cleopatra, among them, are extraordinary instances not only of how meaning gets started rather than merely repeated, but also of how new modes of consciousness come into being. A substantial number of Americans who believe they worship God actually worship three major literary characters: the Yahweh of the earliest author of the Hebrew sacred texts Genesis, Exodus, and Numbers, the Jesus of the Gospel of Mark, and Allah of the Quran. I do not suggest we substitute the worship of Hamlet, for instance, but Hamlet is the only secular rival to his greatest precursors in personality. Like them, he seems not to be just a literary or a dramatic character. His total effect upon the world's culture is incalculable. After Jesus, Hamlet is the most cited figure in Western consciousness. No one prays to him, but no one evades him for long either. Over-familiar, yet always unknown, the enigma of Hamlet is emblematic of the greater enigma of Shakespeare himself, a vision that is everything and nothing, a person who is everyone and no one, an art so infinite, it contains us.
And then the lover, sighing like furnace with a woeful pallid made to his mistress in his eyebrow. And then a soldier, full of strange oaths and bearded like the par, jealous and odd, sudden, quick, and quarrel, seeking the bubble reputation even in the cannon's mouth.
Homily, Part 3, The End. After Professor Bloom's worshipful tribute to Hamlet, you're wondering, well, where is he in our worship service today? My own love of the character is surpassed by my respect for the play on the whole, and so try as I might to edit the Prince of Denmark in order to integrate him into this liturgy, I just couldn't. I will instead share a true story of his impact on one theater goer, and I'll even throw in a famous passage with some context, of course.
When I was 19, several people I was close with all died across a short span of time. My Aunt Dorothea died from stomach cancer. My best friend Megan was killed in a car accident right after college graduation. And a good school chum of mine from high school, Maddie, her mother died of breast cancer. All three deaths happened within months. This was my first experience with real loss, and I was untethered. I felt quite alone. Just a couple of months passed, and Maddie's father quickly remarried. The new wife was her deceased mother's best friend. Maddie was the youngest in her family with two older brothers, unwilling to consider the implications. Maddie also felt quite alone. During this time, I staged-managed a production of Shakespeare's Hamlet. I was just getting my start, and it was exciting to hang out with more experienced professionals, to get to go to the after parties, and feel a part of something. My friend Maddie came to opening night. One of the most riveting scenes in an already riveting play is the so-called closet scene. The young Prince Hamlet visits his widowed mother Gertrude in her private quarters to confront her about her new marriage, too soon after his father's death. Hamlet's father is murdered, in fact, by the very man to whom Gertrude is now married. She is willfully ignorant of this, refusing to face the terrible truth. She dares ask Hamlet, "What have I done?" Hamlet answers, "Such an act that blurs the grace and blush of modesty, calls virtue hypocrite, takes off the rose from the fair forehead of an innocent love, and sets a blister there, makes marriage vows as false as dicer's oaths. Oh, shame wears thy blush." And he's just getting started. Hamlet becomes so wild with anger that the ghost of his father intercedes to demand that Hamlet be gracious with Gertrude, telling him, "Step between her and her fighting soul, and have mercy on your mother." Maddie found me after the show. I wanted to hear what she thought of the production, which actors she liked. Gee, what was her favorite scene? She was red-faced and teary. She had no accolades. Instead, the first words out of her mouth when she saw me were, "Patricia, I didn't even know I was allowed to be angry. My dad was having an affair with my mom's best friend while mom was dying, and no one said a word." The play wasn't entertainment for Maddie. It was a revelation. Until she witnessed Hamlet's righteous anger at his mother's unsavory marriage, Maddie thought she was a bad person for being angry with her widowed father. She said, "I watched Hamlet lose his mind, and I thought, yep, that's me. And then he's able to forgive her. I still love my dad, but I just need him to know how bad it hurts." As for me, I knew in that moment, this was a story I'd be telling again and again, all my life as testimony to a certain kind of power. The closet scene revealed something to Maddie that was beyond easy explanation. In the last analysis, the theatrical experience for Maddie rehearsed something for her. It rehearsed for her a way to respond, granting her permission to cry out with a broken heart so that it could be healed. In turn, Maddie's testimony reoriented me. Something happened when my friend confessed her broken heart. I witnessed the impact of Shakespeare's power to reveal us to ourselves in ways that, well, free us. Before Maddie, I did my work as an artist because it was fun. It gave me a tribe, and I was good at it. After Maddie, I did my work as an artist knowing something could always be at stake for someone. For me, there are really only two things: the story and the witness. Is it a story worth telling, and will anyone care? Does the story give voice to something otherwise misunderstood, or worse yet, suppressed? And are there people who need to hear that voice in order to find their own? The sixth age shifts
into the lean and slippered pantaloon with
spectacles on nose and the pouch on the side.
His youthful hose, well saved.
A world too wide for his shrunk shank. And his big, manly voice turning again towards childish treble,
pipes and whistles in his sounds.
The last scene of all that ends this strange, eventful history is second childishness and mere oblivion. Sans teeth, sans eyes, sans taste, sans everything.
Let us say our unison benediction. Engage with the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return to no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak.
Help the suffering. Honor all beings.
You may be seated. Have offended, think but this and all is mended, that you have but slumbered here. While these visions did appear, and this weak and idle theme no more yielding but a dream, gentles, do not reprehend. If you pardon, we will mend. And as I am an honest puck, if we have unearned luck now to scape the serpent's tongue, we will make amends ere long. Else the puck a liar call. So, good day to you all. Give me your hands if we be friends, and Robin shall restore amends.
So many thanks to our players of words, players of music, players of worship, you who created this for us, thank you so much. I do want to remind you that we do have a special meeting that is happening at 11:30, so please, voting members, do stick around, enjoy our time in fellowship, continue to play a bit, and we will have our meeting at 11:30, which is when our Zoom folks are planning to join us as well. If you do need to leave and you are voting members of the church, please do log in on Zoom. We do need your vote today. Thank you.
It's a lot easier when you're playing for me, too.